head. Drive the nails in my hand to laugh at me. Where you stand, go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see, 'cause I'll rise again. Ain't no power on earth can keep me down. Yes, I'll rise. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and mark my name. My love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I'll be free, 'cause I'll rise again. Ain't no power can keep me down, 'cause I'll rise. I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and say I'm dead and gone, but you'll see that you are wrong. Go ahead and try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one. 'Cause I'll rise again. Oh, ain't no power on earth can keep me down. Yes, I'll rise, I'll rise, I'll rise, I'll rise, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Yes, I'll rise, I'll rise again. Oh, ain't no power on earth can keep me down. Yes, I'll rise. Thank you, Lord. Death can't keep me on the ground. Death couldn't keep him on the ground. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Death couldn't keep my Lord in the ground. Death can't keep me in the ground.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, the son gave his life for me. When he died on Calvary, there is no greater love. No greater love than a man should lay down his life for a friend, Poor God so loved the world that he gave his only son, the son gave his life for me. When he died on Calvary, there is no greater love. There is no greater love than a man would lay down his life for a friend.
There is no greater love.
There is no greater love. save a wretch like you and me. That's gotta be love. That's love. Yeah. Jesus went to Calvary
to save
a wretch like you and me.
Bye.
Christian love ain't got nothing on that love. Yeah. 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 That's love. That's love. That's love. My God, love me.
My soul.
Hey. I don't know about y'all, but that's love. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Jesus went all the way to Calvary just to save a wretch like me. I bet you wouldn't do it. I know I wouldn't do it. It took the Father to send his Son to do it. Pastor Bonner wouldn't do it. Hallelujah. James Taylor wouldn't do it. That's love. He saved me, he healed me, he loved me, he raised me. That's love.
Amen. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. That's love. That's love. That's love. Oh, yes. Play it, Evan. Blow that sax. Oh, yes.
At this time, we're going to present...
That's love.
A baptismal certificate. Brother Quantrell, we baptized two, but Michael had to leave. We'll probably present his next Sunday, should he be here.
Amen.
Can you come forward?
Amen. Amen.
All right.
Say amen.
Amen.
Reverend Davis was just sharing with me during the time of the baptism that he had remarked to Reverend Harris that these two young men that were baptized, they represent such a beautiful picture. Because we hear so much on the news about our young black men killing one another. But to see them, it is something that gives you hope, and that gives you a sense that somehow the Lord is going to work this thing out. Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, at last number. That last song, that's love. That song cuts me to my heart. When I think about all that the Lord has done. Just for a few moments, because I realize that this service is loaded. When I say loaded, I'm talking about a lot that we have to do, but I think that we have rationed our time, and we've used it wisely. And after the message and the announcements, then we will go into our Lord's Supper. Just for a few moments, turn with me to John's Gospel, chapter 20. Because all four Gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when you put them together, we get a composite picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord. And during the time when, the trials leading up to his arrest, and then while he hang there on the cross for only 6 hours, that normally it took longer for a person to die in that condition. Do we have, no, we don't have it on the screen, do we? Okay. All right. Well, if wherever you are seated, if somebody's close to you with a Bible, or it's on the screen now. Oh, okay. All right. Good, good. Beginning at verse 1, and let's stop at verse 9, the first 9 verses. The first day, let's everybody together, are we ready? Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, going a little bit too fast. Okay.
Simon Peter and the other disciples.
Jesus loved.
And said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they have put it.
So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running. To Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one. Well, I'll tell you what. Let me read it. Let me read it. Cause the way that's jumping, that's confusing me. Let me read it. Yeah, I'm gonna start over verse 1, and I'm reading from the King James. Thank you, audio department. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth, and that other disciple, and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying, yet went he not in. Then cometh Simon Peter following him and went into the sepulchre and seeth the linen cloths lie and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in also that other disciple, which came first to the sepulcher, and he saw and believed. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. So end of God's holy and precious word. You may be seated. We want to look at, just briefly, this thought, what they saw. What they saw. I realize that for years, well, if any of us have lived any length of time, that the Lord has blessed us to see many Easters. And I cannot speak for anybody but myself now, but when I was younger, Easter, during the culture that I was coming up in, Easter was more of a time for getting, for mama to get me some new shoes, new suit, tie, shirt, matching and everything, and then for us to come to church and parade and to look good. Of course, after that, the attire didn't look too good a couple of Sundays later. But as I've gotten older, Easter has taken on a different meaning. And especially this particular Easter, and I don't know why, I can't explain it. But it has taken on a very personal meaning for me this year. And I thank God that every now and then, he knows how to break through our minds and our hearts and get us to see the real truth and what he wants us to understand in terms of our lives. John here, and let me make mention of this, we want to use a background scripture out of the 10th chapter of John, verses 17 to 18. And let me turn to that very briefly and read that. John, Jesus here is speaking, and chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life, that I might take it again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. If you go to the 20th chapter of Matthew, Matthew tells us that at first light, and John in his description tells us that it was still dark, and the light had not dawned yet, the rooster had not crowed, that two Marys, one of them was Mary Magdalene, the one that Jesus had spoken and seven demons came out of her. They were going to the grave site. And in going to the grave site, their purpose was to anoint the body of Jesus with extra spices. Because we know the gospel writers tell us that after Jesus hung his head and died, and they took his body off the cross, that Joseph of Arimathea went to Pilate to beg his body. Then he and Nicodemus, they wrapped the body quickly. One commentator said with about 70 pounds of spices, because it was getting close to the Sabbath. And so they had to, and one thing about the Jewish religion, that they were not to touch anything dead, nor be around anything that was dead. So they had to quickly wrap the body, his body, and then between the layers of the cloth, they put very strong Aramaic spices. And those spices helped to cut down on the odor of the body that was decaying, but they didn't get a chance to finish. So when the beginning of the week came, which was after the Sabbath, And the early Christians they called that the first day of the week. In fact, they started collecting and coming together and worshiping God on the first day of the week, and they called that the Lord's Day. And they were going to the tomb, the two Marys. And as they were going to the tomb, they were talking about, they had a conversation, and they were saying that, who are we going to get to roll that massive stone from the entrance of that tomb? Because the stone that they had rolled to cover the entrance of Jesus' tomb, we're not talking about a little small pebble. We're not talking about a couple of rocks that were piled up to cover the entrance, but we're talking about a massive boulder that took at least about 3 to 4 men to push it and to roll it down an incline from the face, from the opening. And the two Marys, they were trying to figure out, who are we going to get to remove that stone? And so as they were talking and as they were approaching the grave site, they didn't know that the Jewish, the high priests and the other Jewish leaders, they had gone to Pilate, and they said to Pilate, he said that he's going to get up in 3 days, but to make certain that his disciples do not come and steal his body, and then go about publicizing the fact that he got up out of the grave. We were asking if you would put a guard, a Roman guard, over the entrance of the tomb and then seal it with a Roman seal. So Pilate said, so be it. So he allowed them to do that. But the two Marys, they didn't know about the Roman soldiers that were there guarding the entrance of the tomb. But to show you how God works, and I don't care what anybody says, when God gets ready to move, all hell cannot stop him. Satan cannot stop him. When the two Marys got to the tomb, the stone was rolled away. The guards, Matthew tells us that when the angel came down and rolled back the stone, the angel was so, how can I say it, he looked like lightning. And of course, you know, you can try to imagine that in your own mind, and that the robe that he was wearing was as white as snow. And because of his appearance, it caused the guards, I'm using the terminology, they became paralyzed, they became frozen. And maybe some of God might have even blinded them, I don't know. But when the two Marys got there, the guards were not a problem. The stone was not a problem. Life always has difficulties. Max Lucado, in one of his books, talked about God still moves stones. Amen? The two Marys, when they got there, their stone and their impediment, their problem was gone. Now, God just didn't do it for them, but he still does it now. He still moves stones of sickness in our lives, stones of financial ruin, stones of hate and anger, despair, stones of misunderstanding. These are stones that he moves in all of our lives. And not only has he done it before, but God is still moving those type of stones that cause an impediment and progress as we go on in this life. The two Marys, when they got there, there was an angel waiting on them. And Matthew and Mark tell us it was one angel. Luke and John says there were two, but don't get caught up in terms of that the one, they were confused, or one contradicts the other. No. It ain't important about how many angels were there. In fact, really, if it was 10 angels, it really don't make no difference. There were angels that had been dispatched from heaven, and they had come as messengers from the Father, in order to aid in terms of the witnessing of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now the angel said to them, fear not, right? And then the angel said, he is not here. Now, to be told that Jesus was not there, there would not have been no welcome news to those two Marys or to anybody else that was looking for the body of Jesus. But if the angel had not added, he is risen, then that's different. We cannot listen to those who say, lo, here is Christ, or lo, there he is, for he is not here, for he is not there. Jesus Christ is risen. He is not here nor there, but he is sitting there at the right hand of his Father. For those that are seeking Christ, you must understand that the risen Christ has come up from the dead. And the only way that you can seek him, you got to seek him in faith, reverence, humility, and with a heavenly mind. It's good that sometimes we say it is good to be here, and we're talking about being a part of the fellowship of the saints and the service. But we got to understand Jesus is risen. Do you understand what I'm saying? He ain't here. He is seated at the right hand of his Father. Now, the Holy Spirit is with us, but Jesus is up there. Amen? And our hearts, whenever we are giving glory to him and praise and magnification, that's the reason why we're told in Scripture to look up to the hills from what? From whence cometh our help? Our help comes from where? From the Lord. Now, saying that, this brings me to the heart of our message this morning. The few verses that John shows here in our text, that these disciples, Mary, John, and Peter, they used their eyes. Or we can say they used the eye test. But John in here uses different words to describe how Mary, Peter, and John, how they did use their eyes. Notice here, first of all, John says that Mary seeth the stone rolled away. Then when John arrived, John said he seeth the linen cloths lying. Then Peter, he says, beholdeth the linen cloths lying and the napkin lying separate from the rest of the cloths. Then it is said that John saw. Bear with me. Let me go back. You understand where I'm coming from? Mary sees. John sees. John sees the linen cloths laying there. Then when Peter comes and looks in, then Peter sees not only the linen cloths that had been wound around his body, but a separate napkin that had been wound around his head. Now, when John says that Mary seeth, the Greek word here that he uses is the word belpo, B-L-E-P-O, belpo, which means just to see. It means it's just an ordinary word. It's just looking out with one's vision. Now, when John came and stooped down and looked into the tomb, he also saw in the same Greek word what Mary saw. Even though he saw the linen cloths, John and Mary just saw. Amen? Mary and John, they're not alone in just seeing their lives and seeing Jesus. A person can just see another person outwardly. You can see the wrapping of their skin. But you can never see their hearts, nor know their minds, nor feel what they feel, or take time to know their story unless you take time to commune and fellowship with them. Let me just throw this in as a nugget. That's the reason why when we're young men and women, when they are coming up, have to be all so careful about, in terms of when you are trying to choose a mate to marry, that you don't look at the covering. You just don't see the outward form, whether it's beauty or not, because I know beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I understand that. But you got to go beyond the skin wrapping. You understand what I'm saying? The only way you can know a person's heart and mind, know their aspirations, the purpose in their life, you got to commune with that person. You got to walk with them. You got to talk with them. You got to listen to them in terms of opening up their soul to you. And this takes time. This doesn't come about in a couple of days or a couple of weeks or a couple of months. It takes time to know the inside of an individual. Just don't see. Because everything you see ain't what you think you see. And everything you done seen is not exactly what you think you saw. Because looks can be what? Deceiving. You can take a rotten, not a rotten egg, because rotten egg smells too bad. You can take a rotten piece of, let's say a rotten piece of fruit, and you can put it in a box. You can wrap it in beautiful gold paper. You can tie a big, beautiful bow about it, and you can put sequences on it and give it to an individual. And you can tell them, this box contains a prize for you. Now, if they were to assume what's on the outside is emblematic of what is good on the inside, they're in for a rude awakening. Amen? Now, it could be, but if one wanted to maybe pull a joke on somebody, they could have something on the inside that was near, that was not anything close to what looked pretty on the outside. Mary and John, they saw, but they didn't see. Let me go a little bit further. Let me embellish this. This is a problem that with our age of electronics and computers, everything that is a blessing has a corresponding side for cursing. Our world has been brought closer together, and I admit, with smartphones and with social media, this sort of thing, but machines and gadgets are impersonal. Sure to get quiet there. Machines and gadgets keep us from really knowing one another, touching one another, having intimacy. That intimacy is lost. I can see your face on a internet screen, and I can talk with you on that screen, and you can tell me anything from that screen. You can lie from that screen. Amen? But now, if I meet with you and talk with you personally, it's not that easy to lie when you and I are looking eyeball to eyeball. You understand where I'm coming from? Now, the internet screen ain't no problem. That's the reason why that we've had so much crime over the internet. People are opening up their lives and putting it out on the internet. Young men and women being bullied and their lives being threatened. Now again, don't misunderstand me. There are some good things about the mechanics and about the internet. But like with everything in life, everything, if it's good, it has a downside. And because man is sinful, he's going to try to explore what? The downside of anything that's good. And he's going to try to what? Work it into a point where it will favor him, but it will hurt other people. Let me move on. Now, when Peter came to the tomb, John said he beheld. The word for Peter's use of his eyes is theorio, T-H-E-O-R-E-O, theorio. This word suggests far more than just seeing something. It means that Peter looked critically and carefully at what he saw. I'm sure that it had an effect on Peter, because later on, in the second chapter of Acts, the day of Pentecost, when Peter preached, 3,000 souls were saved. And Peter, as you know, preached on what? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Then, when John went in, now we have an entirely different word for what John saw. The word that is used here in Greek is eido, E-I-D-O. This word, while describing the use of the eyes, always conveys the idea of apprehending something, understanding something of what you see. When John went in, notice he said, he saw. And when he saw, he understood. He knew what had happened. And then when he understood, he believed. Notice the sequence here. He saw. He understood what was going on, that Jesus had what? Had risen, as he said, when he saw the clothes lying down. And when he saw that, he what? He believed. Now, admittedly, we're living in a culture where a lot of people, when they read the Word of God, or when they see God performing miracles, they still are skeptical and doubtful about this. But one thing that God does not do that I found out, he does not force his salvation on anybody. He won't do that. What he does, as the song said, God is a God that moves in mysterious ways. You can't figure God out. No use of trying to trace his hand. That's what Habakkuk tried to do, but Habakkuk found out you can't trace the hand of God. You can't do it. You got to let God be God. You got to let God do what he wants to do when he chooses to do it, which implies what? The sovereignty of God. Now, we don't like God to be sovereign, do we? We don't like him to be sovereign. You know why? Because his sovereignness overrides our wanting to be in control. And sin makes us want to be in control. And God says, you ain't in control. You know, never have been. You thought you were, but you never have been in control. Because I made you. I blew breath in your lungs. And anytime that I choose, I can stop your ticker from ticking one or twice. You gone. There's no way for you that you are going to tell me what's best for you. Now, if you want to charter your own course, that's fine. But I have a better what? Plan for your life. I have a plan that will bring you what? Prosperity. I have a plan that will bring you joy and peace. I have a plan where he says at the end of the Psalm 16, where in my right hand there are pleasures forevermore. John's seeing gave him intelligent insight. It produced absolute conviction. John knew this to be true, though the body of Jesus was not there. Now, let's look at this from our perspective. The question, as I conclude, is this. This morning, what do you see? Mary saw just the ordinary. Nothing fazed her. John saw something a little bit more than Mary did. Peter saw something critical. John, what he saw, it brought salvation to him. He believed. Now, the question, in order that we hear on this, maybe for some of us, this might be our last Easter Sunday. We may not see another one next year, because between now and next year is a long time. And none of us has any papers in our pockets now to guarantee that we're going to be alive to see another Easter next year. Amen. All we can do is just pray by the grace and by the mercy of God that if it is His will, so be it. If it's not His will, then that's why I'm posing the question. If it's not God's will that you or I, who knows in terms of where death is going to stop, that we're not here for next year, the question is this: are you ready to see the Lord? Well, let's back up. You can't see Him if you don't know Him. And you can't know Him if you don't believe in Him. Amen? Now, let's again go to the eye test. When I looked at you, all of you look beautiful. You are dressed very suavely. Ladies, you are perfect. Men are handsome. But see, with my eye test, all I can see is just the wrapping, the box, and the paper that's round around the box. But you see, I don't know what's on the inside. You understand where I'm coming from? Now, God knows, but I don't know what's in your heart. I don't know whether you have surrendered to Jesus Christ. I don't know in terms of whether you have said to Him, "Yes, Lord." And all that we have with us today, all they had was just a few little scrolls wrapped up. All they had mainly was the Old Testament. We got all of it, the Old Testament, the New Testament. We got signs, we got witnesses, we got people living. In fact, let me say it like this. There is somebody here I know this morning that God has moved some stones in your life. Oh, yes. It might have been a stone of sickness that He raised you from your sick bed. He might have healed cancer. I don't know. He might have even come in when there was financial ruin. You about maybe to lose your home or your job. God stepped in. He brought a check. Somebody came to your rescue. You didn't even have the wildest imagination that they were going to be there. But God moves in mysterious ways. And let me tell you, I know that as a witness myself. And I know that God can move stones in anybody's life, but you got to believe. All things are possible. All things. You remember that time when in the Old Testament when God had told Abraham, "You're going to have a son in your old age." And then the angels had visited Abraham and Sarah overheard it. Eavesdropping, and ladies, you know y'all love to eavesdrop. And then Sarah, when she heard it, she started laughing. As old as I am, ain't no way in the world I can get pregnant now. Everything on me is dead and dried up. And then God who heard her laughing, said, "Is there anything too hard?" In other words, is there anything I can't do? And God performed what? The impossible. And He's still performing the impossible. He ain't changed.